One.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Offstage. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. We have an exciting show for you tonight. Along with the good word from our friends in Public Works Dallas and the Education Department at Dallas Theater Center, we'll also be catching up with Martin Rayner, a former and fabulous member of our acting company. And we have an update on our production of Something Grim. But first, let's get a check on the weather with Imani Thomas, social media manager and avid weather enthusiast. Imani, over to you.
Hi, Amy. It's been a long time coming, but temperatures are back in the 70s, and it's finally time to wear shorts again. I'm gonna go talk to some people and see how they feel about the weather. What do you think about this good weather we're having, sir? How's the weather down there? Crazy weather we're having, right? Well, you heard it here first. The Texas weather is back. Back to you, Amy.
Well, thank you so much, Imani, and stay safe out there. Public Works Dallas is keeping busy and getting ready for spring workshops. Stephanie Cleghorn-Hasso, Associate Director of Public Works Dallas, and Maria Calderon, Public Works Dallas Coordinator, join us now with more information. Ladies, take it away.
Hello, thank you so much, Amy. Hello to all of our Facebook friends. Again, my name is Stephanie Cleghorn-Hasso, she, her. I'm the Associate Director of Public Works Dallas at Dallas Theater Center. I'm joined by my teammate, Maria Calderon, our Public Works Dallas Coordinator, and we want to tell you what we are up to. So right now we are gearing up for our Spring Bravo workshops. Our workshops are always free to the community. We've been virtual this year, so we're gonna stay virtual for our Spring Bravo term. So we'll have three different virtual locations, different days, different times, and for different age groups. So I think we're gonna put up on the screen ways you can learn more if you're interested in participating and how you can reach out to us. I wanna give a shout out to our public artists, Yvonne Hassel, Tiffany Solano, and Brandy Giles. So excited for the work that they've been doing and that they're going to do for Spring Bravo. I also want to highlight our community partners, Aspire, Bachman Lake Together Family Center, City of Dallas Beckley Sainer Recreation Center, City of Dallas Janie C. Turner Recreation Center, and Jubilee Park and Community Center. So for Spring Bravo, we have a lot of exciting things for you. We'll have guest artists, we'll get ready for our spring, our summer showcase. And speaking of summer, this year, 2021, is gonna be a little different for summer. Our community is used to a big pageant production. We've had a pivot this year due to health and safety protocols, so we're gonna have a summer showcase. What that means is our community is going to devise and create their own production, and then we're going to film at three different partner locations. So if you want to join us in the fun, reach out to us. That film, it's going to be our Public Works Dallas movie. It'll be available to the public and for free. But if you want to be an actor, if you want to join us in our workshops, a volunteer, or learn how to support, you can reach out to me directly. And I think we're going to drop my email in the chat. Stephanie.Cleghorn@DallasTheaterCenter.org. And we look forward to welcoming new faces into our space. And I'm gonna pass it over to Maria to tell you a little more.
Thank you, Stephanie. Thank you, Amy, and everyone for joining us tonight. Hola, Maria Calderon, Coordinadora de Public Works Dallas. Y yo quiero hablar de uno de los pilares que marcan nuestro trabajo, que es la hospitalidad radical y la inclusión. Eso implica que toda nuestra programación es accesible para toda la comunidad de Dallas. Por eso honramos el español como una de las dos lenguas principales que se hablan en nuestra comunidad. Toda nuestra comunicación con la comunidad es bilingüe, así como uno de nuestros talleres, y todos nuestros ensayos para la obra anual son en dos idiomas. Y la letra y el diálogo a veces se traducen para que existan los dos idiomas en el espacio. Todos son bienvenidos aquí en Public Works Dallas. Do not worry, I will translate now. One of the pillars that marks our work is radical hospitality and inclusion. And that means that all our programming is accessible for everybody in the community of Dallas. That is why we honor Spanish as one of the two primary languages in our community. All our communication to the community is bilingual, as one of our workshops, which is entirely bilingual. All rehearsals for the annual pageant are also led in both languages, and the lyrics and dialogue are sometimes translated so that community gets to participate in both languages. All are welcome here in Public Works Dallas, and I will send it back.
Well, thank you so much, Stephanie and Maria. All the beautiful things Public Works Dallas shares with the community are a fabulous reason to celebrate. And I have to say, I'm really excited about a Public Works movie. That is amazing. That is so amazing. I cannot wait, ladies. I cannot wait. I will celebrate you now, and I will celebrate you in the summer. And speaking of celebrating, what better way to celebrate than with a delicious cocktail? Jacob Peterman, manager of box office services, is with us now to share a new drink idea. Hi, Jacob. Take it away. Hi.
Once again, my name is Jacob Peterman. I'm the manager of box office services, but this evening I'm going to be your bartender. So this month's theme for a cocktail is something that's very near and dear to my heart, which is chocolate. I love chocolate. I will eat it whenever. If you ever go to my office, there's usually chocolate in my drawer all the time. So this is a special cocktail I don't make a lot because it's very indulgent, but it's probably one of my favorites. So we're just going to make a nice classic chocolate martini. It only takes three things, very, very simple. You're going to need some type of chocolate liqueur. I personally like the Godiva chocolate liqueur, but again, total preference. You'll need some rum chata, and then you'll also need vanilla vodka. So we're going to get our shaker right here, fill it full of ice. And then this is the very simple recipe. So it's one shot of vanilla vodka, one shot of rum chata, and then two shots of the chocolate liqueur, maybe a little extra if you want a little extra, that's up to you. So we're gonna take this, we're gonna shake it really, really quick. Put it aside. And then if you watched our first video, our first cocktail video, I love doing garnishes. So for this, I got some Hershey syrup. I lined the glass. It doesn't have to look pretty. It can just be really messy. It's chocolate. It's going to taste wonderful. And then I took some Oreos, crushed those up, and then I dipped the rim in Oreos as well, because the more chocolate, the better. Ooh. So we're going to take this. We're going to pour it into one of our martini glasses. Right to the top. That's a proper martini. It needs to be right at the top. And there we have a beautiful chocolate martini. So while you're drinking that, you can also go to our website, dallasleadercenter.org, and check out the brand new information for Something Grim, which is our new production. We're gonna be doing that from March 18th to April 4th. I know we've had a lot of back and forth with it, but this is 100% certain. These are the dates we're gonna do the show. It's a wonderful interactive experience where you're gonna be walking around the Wiley Theater. I've seen it several times now, and it's amazing. It's so cool at night. So definitely go check that out and reserve your tickets. And that's it for me, Amy.
Jacob, how can I follow chocolate and a chocolate martini? Oh my gosh. I wish you could just pass that on over to me, because I don't have a bar set up here, but I may have to go out and get one set up so I can make that cocktail tasty.
Just do it this weekend.
This weekend? How about tonight?
Thanks, Amy.
Thank you, Jacob. And everybody, please, look for Jacob when you go to see Something Grim at the Dee and Charles Wiley Theater. Well, we have, on top of this new show, we have new education offerings coming up soon. And we're partnering with the City of Dallas to bring you even more choices. Morgana Wilborn, Director of Education, joins us now to tell us more. Morgana, nice to see you tonight.
Hi, friends. So glad to see you all. Last time I was here, I was pre-recorded, but I'm happy to be live. I may not have a shot of good liqueur for a nice chocolatey martini, but I do have something exciting that you can drink your martinis with, or you drink your martinis too. And that is the Something Grim Production Classroom. We have a special event this Friday, March 12th, from 6 to 7 p.m. Central Time, for those who may tune in from all across the nation. It'll be a very special Q&A with the design team for Something Grim. So if you're like, what is Something Grim? What does immersive mean? What does it mean to watch theater outside, walking around? How do you do the lights? How do you do the sound, the costumes? How do you protect yourselves during a pandemic? Learn from all of our heads in the production department who also happen to be our design team, which includes scenic designer John Slauson, costume designer Michael Heath-Wade, lighting designer Nicole Iannacone, and sound designer Kyle Jensen for this special conversation about bringing this unique production to life outside the Wiley Theater. It is multimedia, it is special, it will help you appreciate the Arts District and what DTC and the magic of the Wiley has to offer. And the way that you can join this special Zoom conversation moderated by our wonderful Miss Amy Lacey, who also hosts Offstage, but you get to see that beautiful lady twice this week. Get ready. It's just $10. And if you want to buy an all access pass, just $35. We try to make equitable prices for our community. So just contact us. You can visit our website at dallastheatercenter.org. Click on education, choose production classroom, and voila, you'll find out more information on the Something Grim production classroom. But it doesn't stop there. You also can tune into videos and information, inquire about past production classroom live Q&As, and visit more about how we produce the beautiful work that we have had on our stage. If you want to learn more about education, virtual classes, upcoming summer, or the very special collaboration with City of Dallas Park and Recreation Centers, you can visit dallastheatercenter.org. You can visit on Instagram at educationdtc or email us at education@dallastheatercenter.org. I'm very excited about the collaboration with the City of Dallas. We will be hosting a special class that starts March 27th. What's really cool is that you can access the registration that will take you to Parks and Rec, but you can scan it via QR code on our website. It's right on the landing page if you want to learn more. So not only can you engage with us to learn what goes on behind the scenes, which is Something Grim Production Classroom, but if you have a special student who wants to take our Youth Performance Showcase, which is our collaboration with Dallas Park and Recreation Centers, visit our landing page, scan that QR code, and register. You can always connect with me at education@dallastheatercenter.org. I'm going to stop blabbing because there's more special things to come. Thank you, Amy, for engaging with me. And I'll see you all, friends, on the other side. Have a great night. And drink a sip of martini for me.
Morgan, thank you so much for being here with us this evening and sharing all of the great things that you are sharing with the world through the Education Department at Dallas Theater Center. I can't wait for our production classroom Friday night. It is going to be a blast. If you haven't been to one of those, please. This one tops them all. It's the first time, as Morgana said, that we have had all four of our design team members present and in the same space to talk about the magic that they make. And we'll be there. Morgana, myself will be there. It is great fun. You can ask all of the questions. So we hope to see you again on Friday night. And we always love having you on the show, Morgana. Thank you so much. And can't wait to catch up with you again soon. Speaking of a good catch up, Martin Rayner, who was a member of the acting company with both Adrian Hall and Ken Bryant, is with us this evening. Martin, thank you so much for joining the space with us tonight. It's so good to have you here and sharing this space with everybody on their Facebook Live audience.
Well, that's my pleasure, Amy. It's good to be here.
I'm so happy that we were able to connect with you. As you and I have been catching up prior to tonight, you know, mm-hmm. We've been looking for you. We've been trying to find you and just, you know, bring you back to the family and learn about all of the things that we missed out on with your time with Adrian and Ken. So I'm so excited to have you here tonight and getting to share some of those stories with our audience.
Well, thank you. And, you know, I've been roaming around LA and New York all these years. So it's good to be coming back to where I began in Dallas. It was my first experience in America.
Your first experience in America, Dallas. That's amazing. Well,
yeah.
How did that come to be, the first place that you experienced in America?
Well, I certainly didn't know about the Dallas Theatre Center. I didn't know anything about Dallas. I didn't know about Adrian Hall. I was completely ignorant. But my son, who was just a year old, had come with his mother to Dallas. We had amicably split up, and we were in London. And I wanted to be with him while he was growing up. So I wrote a one-man show and did it in San Francisco. And as soon as I got my union card, I headed straight to Dallas, and just happened to be serendipity that Adrian had arrived and was about to start a company. And I did my one-man show in my former wife's house, and someone saw it who was a friend of Adrian, and they said, hey, you should check out Martin Rayner. And that was that. I landed on my feet.
Oh, my goodness. How lucky for us.
Because lucky for me. Because I was a prissy English actor, and Adrian just whipped me into shape. You know, I thought I was God's gift to the theater, you know, being English. And he soon set me straight on that one.
Well, Martin, I know from the history that I have been able to access about your time here that you have had some iconic roles with us, from Ariel in The Tempest to Scrooge in A Christmas Carol. Can you tell me, of all of those roles, which one was your favorite?
Well, it's neck and neck. I would say probably Mishkin in The Idiot was my favorite role, partly because of the process that we went through, which was really extraordinary. We had a Russian director. We simply took the dialogue from the novel, and we were free to work that. And then I roped in a group called Belody from Deep Ellum, who improvised music throughout the rehearsal and through the performances. And it was an extraordinary production. I mean, a horse came on at the end from out of the car park and dragged Rogozhin away. And I just loved it. I just loved that show. But I mean, there were certainly Enemy of the People, Ariel. Those were really big for me. So many things were learning curves for me at the Dallas Theatre Center. I mean, I had had 12 years in London, but there was so much that I learned coming to Dallas. It was extraordinary for me, a very golden time. And to be a member of a company was an extraordinary thing anywhere. There's nothing like it, to work with other people for 9 years and get to know them intimately and how they work and how they operate. And then it's a family, and you can't help but grow in a way that you can't grow elsewhere. I mean, when you do a, you know, 2 or 3 month production with someone, that's great. But when you have years and can grow and learn, it's wonderful.
I would have to agree. There is great freedom in being in an environment that you have developed that level of trust and communication with people. And that's in part why it means so much to me to have you back with us tonight. It's really a spectacular moment to be able to speak with you this evening.
No, thanks. And with all things, we didn't know at the time quite what we were doing. We didn't know how extraordinary it was. I mean, we knew it was unusual to have a company, but it was, we were doing extraordinary work. Eugene Lee was making extraordinary sets down at the Arts District Theatre, the then downtown Tin Shack, which is a huge airplane hangar sort of place where Eugene Lee could do whatever he wanted, and so could Adrian. So, I mean, it was pretty cutting edge, and it was an unknown quantity. And we didn't know it at the time, but it was a pretty amazing era.
Well, I mean, I can't think of another place where you'd be able to bring a horse.
That's exactly right.
I don't think I'd ever heard before that we'd had a horse in the show.
Oh, well, I'd tell you briefly about that. Now, every time it rained at the downtown theater, I mean, it was bedlam because the rain on the corrugated iron roof was deafening. And that was interesting. But it was an exciting place. And it happened to be snowing at the time, which was unusual in Dallas, and the very end of The Idiot, when the authorities come to drag Rogozhin away. I mean, the metal doors just rolled up, you know, the aluminum doors. And you could see the car park. The audience could see the car park quite clearly with cars. And then this horse comes through the snow and into the building and up a ramp, and lassoes Rogozhin and just drags him off, you know. And it was typical of Adrian, because he didn't believe in magic that you couldn't see. He believed in magic that you could see, you know, like in The Tempest, we had a huge industrial fan for the wind. We had real water. So you weren't wondering where the magic was coming from. You were just watching the effects of the magic, you know. So that horse was a very real thing right next to cars.
That's so amazing. Were there other animals that were actors along with you doing that?
Yes, in the Frank Lloyd Wright Theater, we had we're doing Good. I think it was the production of Good. I played a Jewish guy and his best friend becomes a Nazi, and it's a wonderful, wonderful play. But we had a musical number where there are about 8 goats on stage. And without fail, they all did their business on stage every night. And so, yeah, we had a lot of interesting stuff going. Adrian was a great believer in earth, wind, fire, you know, real things. He'd say, "Hey, darling, we need fire," you know, and "Hey, mud, boys, we want mud," you know, in The Tempest. And we'd all sort of go, "Oh, God, here we go."
You've got Adrian's voice down very well.
Well, I'm going to go see him quite soon, so I'll pass on the amazing things that are going on now. I mean, you know, wow, what you guys are doing now is just extraordinary. I wasn't fully aware of that, being in my little cocoon in LA and so on. But now that I've sort of been woken up by you guys, I'm really astonished at the amazing things you're doing. It's just wonderful to see. I'm just so thrilled.
Thank you so much for sharing those kind words. I have so many questions about goats, but I'm going to move on. mentioned the Kalita. I'm wondering, you know, that it is sort of Dallas Theater Center lore that the Kalita has a ghost, or possibly even ghosts. Did you ever have any otherworldly experiences when working in the Kalita Humphreys?
No goats, but not ghosts. So, so there might have been a ghost of a goat, but I didn't see it. And I don't know if that was a thing back then. I could be wrong, because I was. Oh, wait a minute. No, you're ringing a bell now. I think there was a lady. Is it a lady who was known to walk around?
Kalita.
I think there was. Yeah, I think there was a ghost thing going on then. Maybe I wasn't fully plugged into it, but I think you're right. I think we did. But I didn't have a ghostly experience. I mean, I didn't have Frank Lloyd Wright sort of walk up and say, you know, why is there an elevator in this building? Because he hated them, you know. Right. And I understand, and you probably know, that when his architect told him, when his, not architect, but when he was told that there was going to be an elevator installed, he made the guy get out of his car in the middle of nowhere in Texas and just left him there. He was so angry. So that's Frank Lloyd Wright for you.
Oh, my God.
But no ghost.
Martin, you're just making me so much smarter and have so many more questions. I knew that at one point Dallas Theater Center had to hide the elevator, but I hadn't heard this get out of the car right now business.
That's right. I mean, there are no right angles in the Frank Lloyd Wright Theater, none. And Adrian always used to say, "Hey, we're in this bunker, darlings. We're stuck in this bunker." And but I actually quite liked it. I mean, we loved the downtown space because it was so exciting, but there was something about the revolving stage and I don't know, the big ramp was, you know, Frank Lloyd Wright put a big ramp, you know, for scenery to be carried up. And of course there was the basement space that I directed in actually. And we did Billy Bishop Goes to War with Peter Geraghty down there and Cloud Nine. I loved that space down there. But the elevator, yeah, I didn't know when the elevator was installed. I only knew about that story. I've got poor guy being ejected from the car.
I can't imagine. And probably, like, how do you, you just have to walk at that point. You just better use the feet. No
phone, you know? He was probably in Longview or somewhere ridiculous. Yeah. I loved my years in Dallas. They were my favorite American years. It was a boom town then. The skyline was changing on a monthly basis. It was a very exciting time generally to be in Dallas.
So the Arts District Theater, the Winspear Opera House stands on the ground where the ADT used to be. And Booker T. Washington has, you know, has been around since the, you know, before the Arts District Theater was. But what was the landscape of Dallas like around there other than those two buildings?
I'm trying to remember. It certainly wasn't distinguished because I don't recall. I mean, once the symphony was built, that was a big deal. That's where I met the Queen. And took a while to construct. I'm just trying to remember, there was a huge car park area, I believe. And there wasn't much. I mean, it was land that hadn't been developed much. But I don't remember that. I mean, there was a freeway nearby, of course. Yeah. The 75, is it? Yeah.
75 and then later Woodall Rogers. So they kind of made it
old. And Floral was sort of went nowhere particularly. I'm very vague on that. I don't know. Deep Ellum was an exciting place to go. And that wasn't far away. But I mean, I would just come down 75 from where I lived and go to the ADT. And that was about it, you know, because we were working all the time. I mean, you never really stopped.
Yes.
You didn't see much of the real world because, you know, you were doing shows all the time. And if not there, you would be doing Shakespeare in the park, in the fairground in the summer, or I would work at smaller theaters when we were dark in the summer at the theater center, like Theater 3 and those places. So it was just always busy. I mean, it was a long, long, wonderful, busy, productive time, you know, and a chance to be with my son all those years as he was growing up. And as soon as he was able to get on a plane, I returned to a career in New York and LA, and he was able to come out to those cities and discover those places besides Dallas, you know. But I've always missed Dallas. I mean, I think everybody who was involved in that company and that time holds a very special place in their hearts for it.
There is some beautiful magic that has been created at Dallas Theater Center in so many different eras. So many different sets of magic have happened here. I wish that I could have seen it all firsthand. I'm fortunate to be able to experience the archives and to talk with friends like you, but I have this great sense of missing out for not being able to see those shows firsthand and be
a part. Well, you're in the middle of a golden era of your own. I mean, and there was one before me, and they're all different and they're all very valuable and part of the growth of the arts in the area. And I think what's going on now is like, it's a totally different level of reaching out. I mean, we did those things and we were pioneers in some ways, but you guys seem like you've taken the ball and really run with it. And you seem to have amazing artistic director and And from what I can see, just amazing shows and a lot more organized than we were. Well, I mean, you have more digital possibilities now than we have.
We have a lot of technology, and we definitely have, through the Wiley, it has definitely opened up so many opportunities for us to really stretch our creative wings and explore things that we wouldn't have been able to even consider in the Kalita Humphreys Theater. And
right.
Kevin's leadership, I can't think of another person to lead the way in all of that with the joy and enthusiasm and wonder that he brings to all of this. And I guarantee you, there's no corner of the Wiley Theater that will be left unused and untouched while he's here. So that's very fortunate to have that.
I totally get that. I get that impression that he's, from what I've seen, it's just amazing how he's used the space in so many different ways. And in a way, he's the modern version of Adrian in this way. I'm coming to visit Adrian soon in Van, Texas. And of course, I'll come to Dallas. But I get the feeling that he's the modern version of the sort of spirit that Adrian represented.
Well, Martin, I know that you've been working on both coasts. Where can we find you and your work now? What is next for you? What projects do you have lined up?
Well, there's going to be, I just shot a thing out in Boston for PBS Great Performances, which is a show called Now Hear This. And usually it's a documentary about classical composers, which actually is quite interesting. I watched some of them, and it's really, really well done directed by Harry Lynch and Scott Yu. But in the particular episode that I got involved with, I had played Sigmund Freud in New York City, and it had been a big success there. And so they had me play the ghost of Sigmund Freud, analyzing the ghost of Beethoven for this particular episode. And that's going to May 7th, and I think it's going to be good. It's got a really good script, and gosh, it was really fun to shoot. I mean, we were in a big manor house out there in Boston, and near Boston, and I got to hold a $21 million Stradivarius, and these world-renowned musicians were playing within there. I mean, that was the most wonderful part of it. Actually, it was these world-renowned musicians playing right in front of you. I mean, 3 feet away. Who cares about acting when you're watching? So no, I jest. But it was really a wonderful episode to shoot. So that's my latest thing. I recently did. The production that we did in New York. I did a production of Freud's Last Session in L.A., which was received very well. And a production of who's the guy who pokes his eyes out? Oedipus. I can't believe I didn't remember that one. With the COVID situation, you know, it's all been a bit strange. So I do voice work here, and I've been working on a cottage I bought up in north of San Francisco, amongst the redwoods there, and been working on that a great deal. So I've been biding my time as this virus has been impeding us. And I'm hoping now that there's light at the end of the tunnel, I'm hoping to jump back into some stage work before I'm too much of an old fogey to do it. You know, I'm totally game.
This is all wonderful. I mean, it comes back to ghosts. We're talking about ghosts of Beethoven and Sigmund Freud. And that May 7th is a date that I have on my calendar, because I can't wait to see how that unfolds. But I thank you so much for sharing this space with us tonight. And I hope that this is just the first of many opportunities to be able to get to know you better and share your experiences, both then and upcoming, with all of our friends here in Dallas. And I just
I look forward to that. I really do. I think that now that I'm plugged back in, I will be remaining involved and following you guides. You guides. What does that mean, even? All right. But thank you very much for having me on. And I wish you well with all your endeavors that are going on. Very exciting.
Thank you, Martin. It's been so good to spend some time with you tonight.
Yeah, me too.
Well, friends, that's all for this evening and this episode of Dallas Theater Center Offstage. I just want to say thank you to all of our subscribers and ticket holders who have stayed with us through COVID and changes to shows. And in particular, Something Grim. I know that through winter storms, then rainstorms, and all of the things, it's in and of itself has been a journey. But we're so happy to be able to say that March 18th, next week, we are going to open this show and welcome all of you back into our first live audience experience in over a year. You know, it will be over a year. Since we've been able to see you all and enjoy you all and share beautiful creative experiences with you. So thank you so much for everything that you've done to help get us here and for sticking with us. And for more information about the show, visit us online at dallastheatercenter.org. Something Grim is there big on the homepage. You can get all of the information that you need, we hope, about what you can expect. And there's also a way to reach out to us if there's some question that we haven't covered. And please don't forget to follow us on the social network. We're all over the place here on Facebook, Instagram, and all of the other great places that you can find information. Reach out to us there, share your experiences, and don't forget to tune in on April 7th for our next episode of Offstage. Thank you so much and have a beautiful night. Love you all.
Shake, Sinora, shake your body line. Shake, 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 Sinora, shake it all the time. Work, 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 Sinora, work your body line. Work, 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 Sinora, work it.